We're going to have fun and talk about security today. And with temperatures in this room rising, I want to take you to a place that I went to a while ago. When you go on vacation, as a proper operator, of course, you plan ahead, right? You know you're always on call. You work at a startup. Job is 24/7. Flights also, because things break. And so the first thing you do is, of course, you bring your laptop with SSH keys. You're a professional. Like, of course, you've got that on there. Root access everywhere. And then, of course, because you're a true professional, you're senior, right? Reached out to the hotel, got the IP ranges, found out their unified software was a little bit outdated, so I helped them with that. I try to be nice like that. It's very important. And then to help myself, because you know when an incident happens, you don't have time to deal with VPN. I disabled the VPN for my account. It's beautiful. Terraform Apply will just disable it for my account every time. Our security team absolutely hated that. I personally don't understand why. Because first of all, the beach, amazing. Food, amazing. And well, the incident didn't occur, so it really, you only leak access if you actually need access, right? Something like that. But so we tried to not upset our DBAs in the previous talk. We're not going to try to upset our security folks in this talk. And for that, we're going to need a little bit of tooling. And some question for you. Wouldn't it be great to have a tool that gives you access to what you need, when you need it, and only as long as you need it? So in our case, we have probably a little bit of a problem with our remote, which is not the biggest problem. And there we go. Missed a couple of sweet animations there. Spared no expense on that. Had a team working on that for 3 weeks. As it turns out, access control allowed us right in. So this is cool. So really, we're solving three problems here, three questions. So if we translate that to a more concrete example, because if you submit this as a spec, people are not going to read that RFC. People are just going to ignore it because it's not very clear. So you're on the beach. You want TCP access, not any type of other access, which is your what. And then next up, you want access to a production database because somebody did not test their stuff beforehand. No names here, because we protect the innocent and guilty equally. But you know it happens, and it happens way too often. And that's really the where that we're talking about here. And then, of course, what we want to do is, if I timed this right, and this is beautiful, we want to have access from 1304 to 1315. And it took us a lot of time to get this timing right. The reason we want to do 11 minutes rather than 10 is because you know you can never fix that 10-minute incident in the actual 10 minutes. And it really sucks when you get your access revoked right at the end. And so when we've got the what, where, and when figured out, we also need to figure out the why. Because sometimes you work in an industry where restricted access is actually a thing, where you need to be able to show why you access something. Maybe you want to make sure you remain PCI DSS compliant. Maybe you work with critical data. It's good to be able to tell whoever asks, your auditors usually, and your security team, as it turns out, why you needed access. And in our case, we're summarizing the why to incident number 34. Of course, that's a primitive to that we can look up in our incident management system, and in there will be extra information. Really simple sentence. Get TCP access to a production database from 1304 to 1315 to resolve incident 34. And that's pretty much it. Thank you. So now you've got a PRD you can take to your product teams, tell them to build it, and it's really simple. Now, if you were at Nick's talk yesterday, you know where this slide is going. We're not announcing a product. We leave that for the main stage. We're just going to show you a workflow that we prototype and that we think makes a lot of sense. And so we put this on here to make sure that you know that this is not a product announcement. I see some people nodding. Thank you. That is all the legal acceptance that are required from you. This is perfect. And that truly helps us, because now I can show you what we call gate. Project code names are hard. So this is the seventh in a seven-week period of coming up with this workflow. And what we do is we use PagerDuty for response automation. Really simple. When an incident occurs, you know the beautiful sound that will pop up eventually. And of course, nobody wants to be paged. When I was on that beach, I don't want to be paged. Hell, I don't want to be paged any time. But you work for a startup. You get stickers, you get t-shirts, you get pages. And so the next thing we need is, of course, system access. For us, we use Boundary. If you followed the earlier sessions here, it's going to get real easy to roll that out. It was really easy for us. And then finally, we use Vault for the transit secrets engine, for storing our KMS, and of course, for other secrets. And then as you go through that, this happens. We're building our world for HashiWorld, which you might have seen in the other area. And true story, we're having a meeting about this. We're doing a dry run. And I have my iPad next to me, and it triggers a critical alert, right like this. Your ears start bleeding. It's a lot of fun. PTSD triggers. Even if you weren't on call duty for a long time, that sound gives you a little bit of goosebumps. I'm still getting it right now. So that's, it's a great product. It's a product that I know. Just know. So let me switch to my laptop, and we're going to do something here. And then let me see. Wait, how do I switch this over? There we go. And then, so, first open up Boundary. And then, if we hit this, are you actually seeing the same thing? There we go. All right. Beautiful. So we've briefly pre-recorded this authentication, because I'm not going to leak my credentials on screen, because I see people here taking pictures. And even though they get revoked, you know how this thing goes. Because these credentials that you're seeing right now, that's my Microsoft AD account, which gives you access to a lot of information. Boundary might revoke everything, but your Active Directory is infinite. So go through here, and then let me show you what we're doing here. Actually, let me bring this back to a different screen for you, because that makes it easier for me. And there we go. So we see our boundary targets. And what I really need to do here is basically logged in, not very fancy. It doesn't have to be fancy, because when you're solving an incident, things should just work. I don't need flashy UIs. I don't need jQuery effects. I just need something that works. In our case, we knew Postgres was broken. We knew that because of the error that we got. The trigger world degradation in our case meant that we couldn't store some data. So we solved that. If you look at the screen, we've got, for HashiWorld, we've got, of course, Consul and Redis running, Postgres. We need an extra key value store, so that's why we have Redis in there. Also, it's the easiest one to make sure your microservice is actually a microservice. Consul Vault, I think, speak for themselves. And pro tip, if you're designing a difficult system, don't just make it simple so it doesn't break. Not a monolith, just make it simple. People don't want to play riddles at 3 in the morning. I don't. So we're logged into Boundary, and we've got our service. And the thing I want to do here is I want to get access to the Postgres database. And where that gets helpful for me is that when I switch to my terminal, and before somebody asks, yes, this is my actual terminal, yes, this is a theme, no, this is not my actual terminal that I use in day-to-day, because Golang has a great one, but you'll appreciate that this is actually a lot more readable. And so if we load my full environment, make sure it's a bash, we've got some helpers in there to have access to Vault credentials, which makes your life as an operator easier, makes my life easier, because when your security tooling becomes accessible, when your security tooling becomes almost transparent to what you're trying to do in your workflows, that's when you start using it. In a way, that's what Terraform enabled us, because when you take a step back, it is very easy to spin up a lot of services in Terraform. There's no more reason to go through the console, because going from the console back to your code is harder than starting in the code right away. And here with security, it's the same. So we've got a Vault helper. I envision that eventually I'll have a boundary helper in there just to make my life even easier. And so if I copy and paste some commands around from left side of my clipboard to the right side, then we can list our boundary targets. In this case, I'm using a recursive filter because all I want to see is the Postgres instance, because I know that that's the only one I have access to. But if you saw Pete and Megan's demo earlier, if you have console syncing to it and you have hundreds of services in there, you're going to want to use a filter. Because remember, like, we still have only 3 minutes left for our access before it gets revoked. Sorry, four at this point still. So let's print out our targets. And we can see here that the target information actually contains the right information. So we see also a typo that that tells you I set this up via Terraform. And if you can spot that, I have a Terraform sticker for you. If you can spot it, that's even better. So let's go a step further here. If we want to connect to our instance, I'm not going to use the psql command right away. If you don't pronounce it psql, that's also cool. But that's what we're going with today. And HashiConf is for everyone everywhere, no matter how you pronounce these CLIs. And it's kubectl, in case you were wondering. So we've got the boundary connect command. In this case, you notice the Postgres word in there. That's because boundary understands that for Postgres, you have a specific connection type. And of course, we pasted in our target ID just to make sure we connect to the right Postgres instance. The boundary is smart enough that it will tell me that I can't access a different target ID if I put it in there, because I don't have access to it. Security is super happy right now. They're like, hey, this guy doesn't have access for 2 more minutes. And then everything is going to break. But we're going to get there. So if you've ever logged into Postgres, there's always this beautiful welcome screen, definitely on the 14x branches. So we're just going to clear that real quick, because that has no value. And because we've deployed this a couple of times, I already know what's going wrong. So the first thing we want to do is make sure we list our databases. And of course, PagerDuty told us HashiCraft is having some trouble. So I have an idea that I should be looking at that database. Like I said, we built an insanely complex system, but everything runs through this one Postgres database, because we built multiple single points of failure. It's job security and also a lot of more engineering fun. So raise your hand if you can spot what the problem here might be. I couldn't either. But then my colleague pointed it out to me. Wrong owner in this case, because when you use Vault to vend your credentials and you have nice statements in there that tell you what you get access to and what your Terraform deployed services get access to, giving it the owner Postgres means that your user cannot do anything anymore. So let's get rid of that real quick and switch over to something else. For a boundary sticker, what's the command I would want to run here? Now we all just had lunch, and Rosemary made you walk. But I'm sure somebody here knows. No? Man, MySQL really messed everyone up. Alter database, real simple. It takes us all 23 seconds. And we're about to lose our access here, and that's cool. And we're also, of course, because it is the middle of the night in Europe, not in Mexico, where I took that beautiful beach picture, we're also going to grant all privileges. Somebody else can fix that later. We still have like 3 hours of conference left, right? So we want to make sure HashiConf keeps working. HashiCraft. HashiConf also should keep working. So maybe we give access to that as well. So list our database again. And then if you look at it now, owners HashiCraft and I'm sorry, Lef, I know we're really upsetting our DBAs right now with all of this, but we do what we can, because restoring service is the first priority. Making sure the service keeps working down the road, that's a different priority. And you know that this is the truth. So if we switch over to PagerDuty, we've acknowledged the incident. Joke is, the incident was automatically acknowledged because it was assigned to me. That's how you get your colleagues. There's a Terraform provider for PagerDuty where you can set up schedules. And you can do fun tricks there that help you give other engineers an opportunity to learn how incident management is done. It's beautiful what you can do with codification. So what we're going to do is resolve this incident, because we fixed everything. And what we do here, hit the resolve button, going to type in a nice message of how we resolved it. Pro tip is to always include Jira tickets and everything else that you're obviously tracking, probably some angry tweets just for extra color, and at least one cat gif. We couldn't fit that on the screen, so I'm not. But I did make a typo. And the other thing is, of course, we shouldn't fix this. We need to fix this. When you resolve an incident, always use strong language. Because when we look back on an incident and do a retrospective, the first thing we'll do is look at, OK, so what went wrong? Why did it go wrong? Which services were affected? How did we solve it? And if you go like, it was just nothing, don't worry about it. What's the incentive for somebody to spend extra engineering time on preventing that incident in the future? There's not. Language is important. Words are important. Terraform gives you words that deploy. Vault gives you words that help you talk about secrets. And PagerDuty gives you words that give you engineering time to build fun projects or solve incidents in production. And so if we switch back here, you'll notice that at this point, slightly later than expected, my connection was automatically closed. And the reason for that is real simple. Boundary gave me access. Boundary decided I didn't need access anymore. Security didn't even get paged. To me, that's beautiful. And the reason that's beautiful is because if you've ever resolved an incident, you know you keep your terminal alive. Because you had to go through probably a bastion host that you quickly spun up. And let's be honest, that was Amazon Linux 2 AMI that you just popped into your default VPC. Yeah, I hear the chuckle. We've all been there. If you need a script for that, let me know. I've got some Terraform code. Then, of course, you maneuver around the VPN. But because you're in the default VPC, this was much easier. But then, yes, your services are up. And maybe your dashboard is reporting everything green. But is the service truly up? Probably not. So of course, you keep it around, because there was too much hassle to get in there in the first place. And I see some of you nodding. And that hassle is OK, right? Our systems are just like humans, part of evolution. We build something that we think makes sense. We add new things to it. And complexity increases. And ever so often, we need to take a step back and think about it. Is the access system that we have here, does that still make sense? Is it still the right approach? Do we have a good way to solve an incident in the middle of the night when we're not behind a trusted machine? And trusted machine is also an important part here. If you think back to the first slide you saw, that beautiful beach, my laptop there with a key that can access production infrastructure means that we are now officially multi-continent, because my laptop is part of the production infrastructure, because it can access everything in there. Yeah, security really hates that. So if we switch back to the thing we talked about, gate. We talked about response automation. We talked about how Boundary fits into this. And we talked about the transit secrets engine and key value store and everything else that we get from Vault. Of course, we codified everything. The pro tip here is really to use curly braces and a dollar sign if you use variables, because then your variables will actually interpolate. And we deployed everything with Boundary. This is all available in the open source part. And for us, this made a ton of sense. We tried out HCP boundary for that. Because we run it on AWS, it was easy enough to get set up. But you can run this locally. You could run all of this in a Docker container, or, well, several Docker containers. Your RAM might not like it, but doesn't mean that you don't have to. So let's talk about software delivery. Because when we talk about security, you can't give a talk about security without having a little diagram there. And the first thing we want to talk about is the application we're running. In our case, Minecraft. It doesn't matter if you use Bedrock or Java Edition. You can connect from your switch. I've used this joke before, but we spared no expense. We made sure you can connect and build in the HashiCraft world. And of course, we observe our stack. Datadog, really great. Get a nice little line. We saw people logging in early as soon as we tweeted about it. Things worked well, and of course, you know, because things work well, we're able to deploy new features. Like, oh, hey, we forgot the airship. We should add that in there. Or, oops, there was a room that was supposed to only be accessible through the right door, and maybe we placed an extra door that wasn't supposed to be there. So let's build something new. In case you're wondering, that's my editor. It's Goland with the right theme. And if you're looking for a terminal editor, I know people have been talking about this. It's Nano. There are no other choices. Ultimately, build the software, release it with Waypoint, and cycle complete, right? Like, we can go home. This is very cool. I think I exit through here. But then, you know, you want to leave. I think Nick talked about this. You want to release on a Friday. Things go wrong. Today is Wednesday, but it feels like Friday. And so we released, and we observed a different graphic, the one where you get Slack messages, the one where you get PagerDuty alerts that blow your mind or your eardrums. And so when our response automation clicks in, ultimately, you trigger an incident. Real simple. It happens all the time. Now, of course, because this happens at the most inopportune moment, we trigger our response team. And you'll notice that there's at least four people in that picture. You'll notice that what gets out there looks very much like me. Somebody got tricked here. But through the power of PagerDuty, we have a webhook. And that webhook gets a nice payload that we can use for something. PagerDuty and many of the other incident automation systems allow you to put in specific data into your webhook. In our case, what we're doing here, we put boundary project IDs in there. Boundary project IDs are not PII. They are not any kind of information that you can't share outside, because that's not your security layer. And it should never be your security layer. Me knowing which target IDs you're using, randomly generated ones, should not be part of your security stance. Somebody else tells you different, go away. Go and talk to somebody else. So we feel comfortable sharing that information with PagerDuty. Of course, you might say PagerDuty is an external system. How can you trust the system? When we create our webhook, PagerDuty gives us an HMAC. And we can use that to verify that our webhooks are actually what we want them to be. So if we switch this over a little bit, webhook goes into gate. Gate then uses the boundary API to give us access based on the projects that we need access to. So in our case, that was the Postgres database, none of the others. I know those target IDs are really hard to remember, but if you looked at it throughout the demo, we always use the same ID. And I didn't even have to use the ID because I can just filter through service names. Options here then are click the connect button in the Boundary desktop app, if you're that kind of person, or if you just want to go through the Boundary CLI, much nicer. Either way, you'll end up in your database. And then you can fix your incident. And we're good, right? Like, it's all done. I'm happy here. Sadly, that is not all, because incident resolved is not the end. Incident resolved and clicking submit is the end, as far as the human interaction here is concerned. And the reason for that is real simple. I click that button, another webhook gets triggered. That payload goes to gate. Gate verifies the HMAC, as before. Gate goes through the boundary project ID, the scope ID, the target ID. And then, as it's processing that, it revokes the access. That happened at 13:15, roughly 11 minutes ago. And we can observe our application working again, because we can finally create new blocks and store people's buildings and the metadata around those buildings in our application. Where this makes people happy is that at this stage, I can just go back to having fun. And I will tell you, this was the most fun diagram to ever build, for one simple reason. It starts with an unhappy path, and it ends at a happy path, while taking into account security that makes sense. Security gets out of my way. I don't have to tell my security team, hey, look, incident 34, we need access to that. I also don't need to have talks with our CISO about, look, going on vacation, I'm going to need access to all of it. Trust me, I'm not going to do anything bad. And it's not the problem there isn't the interpersonal trust, right? If you work at a startup, that example, you have to trust people. You always have to trust people. But you bring your laptop outside the secure environment of your home office or your physical, like, company corporate office, and your laptop gets stolen, and for some reason you've been running Espresso app to keep everything unlocked because you're doing a live demo, yeah, that's not cool. It gives me stress to think about that, just like that PagerDuty sound. So the way you can solve that is to give yourself or your team access to a service only when you need it. Or you have an outage like that. There we go. That's what I was looking for. So how do we do this? If you've ever seen me talk about anything from HashiCorp, it's usually Terraform. It's because I don't believe in ClickOps. Boundary Desktop is great. Give me the CLI, much easier, because I can script that. I don't like going into UIs to click things together. If I can't codify it, I'm not going to use it. Because if I can't codify it, that's my first security issue. Because now my memory is part, and not my computer's memory, I trust that. My memory is part of the company's security stance. I need to remember to revoke my access. I need to remember to do all these things. Much easier to use a Terraform provider. 2,200 of them available. No reason for you to not use any of that. So we set up 4 different resources. Of course, we build modules around that, because who likes to copy and paste 4 resources with sort of diverging configurations, but then also not? And we make it real simple. Put that in a module. And now, no matter if you have 10 services or 100, life gets easier. That's the beauty of codification. Any demo you build where you have to do things manually is a bad demo, because down the road, you're going to do the same exact engineering. And for us, we wanted to build something that we can operationalize. Would I tell you to run this service in production? Probably not right now. But are we years away from making it operationally suitable for production? Absolutely not. And that's where this thing gets really important. 2,200 providers. So we can use the output from the boundary provider inside a PagerDuty provider. Version 2.5.1 just released last week, added the option to put in those custom headers. And if you look at them there, you can see we're taking the IDs from Boundary as we generate those services and push them right into PagerDuty. Get the HMAC, we verify the HMAC. And this way, even if somebody manages to intercept those webhooks, unless they have the HMAC, which only gets shown to us once, And we trust PagerDuty to not store that as plain text in a database, mostly because there's a document that states how they store it. We know what's happening. And then you'll notice that webhooks from PagerDuty allow you to specify the types of events we want to have. And we really only want two events sent our way. Gate, I'm sure we could build to support much, much more. But I want to give people access when an incident gets acknowledged and when an incident gets resolved, because that's when you need access. Usually, I'm not going to need more access mid-process, at least not if you set it up the right way. If you need more access in the meantime, you're probably better off declaring a different incident. And that is one of privilege escalation. That one should not trigger you. It should trigger your security teams, who then ensure that you have the right policy attached. Now, of course, with all of this, we're still back at our original problem. We want to get TCP access to a production database. And I'm sorry, we need it until 13.16. But we managed to resolve it. So all of this looks fairly theoretical. We prototyped it. We're going to show you live demos around this at our booth. But of course, you might wonder, like, OK, so what do you do if you need slightly more access? And I think that's always a tricky part. At what point do you rope in more people? Of course, if you're on the beach, right away. I don't want to be the one who has to deal with that right now. Partner is killing me. Like, are you on your laptop again? Yeah, just editing some pictures. Don't worry about it. On the beach, corporate laptop. It's not how it works. Bring in people as the incident fans out. Incident management, incident response is really hard. PagerDuty allows us to make it a lot simpler. PagerDuty is not the only tool that you can use for this. If you want to trigger all of this through shell scripts or a tiny Go application, that's OK. Boundary has an API for that that you can use. You could curl it and probably automate it through Postman if you want to do it that way. Though, if we step towards that stage, we're removing the utility of having a webhook that triggers right when our incident happens. And you're weakening your system. So try this out. Think about how this would fit into your own infrastructure. Because that's where you can really make a difference. Anytime you don't give yourself unlimited access to your systems is a good time. Because you don't need to clean up logs. You don't need to think about, did I do everything here? And hopefully, you'll have some automation around that that actually triggers a system as dirty the second a human logs in. The less systems you have to replace, the better for everyone. So our initial problem, get access at a specific time. You can now automate all of that. With HCP boundary, this gets a lot easier because we had to go through the trouble of running our own controller because we wanted to make sure we could break it consistently, which is fun. We had a couple of other components in there that were too simple to run, and we needed to introduce failure. The pro tip there is bring in humans. Don't write documentation. Because when you don't write documentation, especially for your security incidents, it's beautiful. You write documentation afterwards. You'll learn from that incident. Every outage is a great teacher. Every outage that you can resolve quickly is an even better teacher. Because you know what? If I can solve this in 11 minutes, my memory is still fresh. If your outage lasted 4 weeks because your database restore script does not allow selective restore per customer per region, not throwing shade on anyone here, then you know that you're not going to remember everything. You're going to have different scribes and incident commanders taking on different shifts. And when we look at this incident, I knew that the owner was wrong. I knew that the privileges were wrong. Because all it took was one thought of this, and I kept that in there for 10 minutes. But if I hand this over to any one of you after an 8-hour shift that started at 3 in the morning and at around noon, when I finally find somebody who's willing to take this over, yeah, I'm not going to remember all the information. I can't be solving it at the same time as giving myself access, revoking access, and then making sure I take adequate notes. But you're an engineer, right? You solve an incident not by being on a Zoom hoping that you speak loudly and clearly enough for the scribe who's also on the Zoom to take notes. So that's where it gets tricky. Use Boundary. Get some session logging. Make sure you understand what's happening and go from there. And then build workflows like this. If you're interested in this workflow, we have it available in the Dev Lounge, which is in the other building, so down the stairs. We're looking to release the code progressively over the next few months on the HashiCorp Dev Advocates GitHub organization. And we'll have all these parts available. We'll have Gate available. We have the services available. And of course, the releasing tool that we showed you yesterday, which allows you to recreate what we've built. And please do. Please take this as an inspiration. Build something with it. Let us know which parts we're missing. Security workflows are hard. Security workflows are the stuff nobody wants to ever talk about, right? Because how much am I sharing that I shouldn't be sharing? Am I printing environment variables during my talk that I shouldn't be sharing? And then most importantly, if you give people an idea like this and you provide the wrong guidance, boy, Twitter is not a good place to be. So we don't give guidance, we give ideas. Much easier. Make sure you attach the right policies to all of this. When you build this, codify from the get-go. We always talk about least privilege. Least privilege is an empty list. Run it through Boundary, run it through Vault, run it through IAM. All of these tools will tell you which permission you're missing. You add that in there, and you think about what you're adding and why. Code is cheap, right? Documenting your code is even cheaper because it only takes you time at the beginning. Next time, somebody else can read it. Put in copious notes because whoever is resolving that incident will know what to do and where to go. I'm not a native speaker, so I don't want to put a ton of prose in there explaining what it does. So my go-to is two forward slashes, C, colon, and then a link to the official documentation. Makes life super simple for anyone. I've been doing this for years, and every time I see my code where I have done something like that, or every time other people see that, my former boss is somewhere in the audience, I'm told. He can confirm that. It made it easier to resolve incidents. An incident today is something that you didn't think about yesterday. There's no Nietzsche here. There's no deep quote. There's no Sun Tzu being quoted. It's really just a path that we didn't think about. So make your future life easier. Make it more automatic. We started codifying our infrastructure because automation made it so much easier for all of us to do things the right way, to scale out, switch a region, deploy everything around the world. Why are we not doing the same thing for security? Why are we not doing the same thing for making our incidents much more manageable? So with that, my name is Kerim Satirli. I'm a failed stand-up comedian and a senior developer advocate at HashiCorp. Only one of them was a paid job. I'm at ksatirli on Twitter. And with that, thank you so much. You've been a wonderful audience.